designed for a military contract that never came to fruition, the IWI Carmel was basically shelved for a number of years. In 2018, the new leadership of IWI US visited Israel, saw the Carmel, and saw potential in it. Over the next few years, IWI US's new leadership worked with the engineers in IWI Israel to modernize the platform for the US market, change a few things, and also make some updates based on the feedback that they got in testing. And here it is, 2023, and we've got the IWI Carmel. So IWI does have these rifles in testing at various agencies right now. They did say that no one has adopted it yet, but again, you know, there is that option out there. I am pumped to tell you about this rifle right here, and I'm also excited to say that it was made in the US, which is really exciting. And I did get a chance to shoot it. We've test driven it. I think I have about 200 rounds on it right now. Today I did a 3-mag throwdown that I know you guys like. I've done some in other videos as well. And I'm going to go over the features of this rifle. I'm gonna tell you how it shoots. I'm gonna show you the footage from the drills that I shot today. And then I'm gonna tell you a couple things that I didn't quite like about the rifle, but we'll save those for the end. But first, I wanna tell you real quick about my relationship with IWI and how I got this rifle. So I am friendly with several people at IWI. They are kind enough to give me demo rifles like this so I can make videos like this to show you. So they did give me this rifle. No money exchanged hands or anything. All of the ammo that I shot in this is mine. And as I've mentioned in other videos, the scope and scope mount were given to me by Vortex Optics and American Defense Manufacturing, respectively. So that's it for the disclosure. So let's go over some of the features real quick here. So big picture, what we're looking at here is a 16-inch barrel, and it's on a short stroke piston system, and it is a 5.56, does take Stanag magazines. In fact, this is the one that came with the gun right here. And there's a couple clever different uses of material that I'm gonna talk about as I go over the rifle here. But basically what we have is we have polymer, we have steel on these components that are important and wear. And then we have aluminum on the handguard, aluminum on the Picatinny rail. And then we actually have a 1-in-7 twist cold hammer forged barrel. We'll get to that in just a moment here. I know Grand Thumb goes tip to butt. I like to start in the rear. We have a 6-position stock, and you can tell because it has the numbers on there, which I actually really like, because I don't know if you're like me, but it seems like every time I pass off a rifle to someone, no matter if it is in the closed position or the open position, they always put it in the opposite one and mess around with it. So it is nice to have these numbers here you can reference to and just come right back to it. I like to have it on the number 2 position. Soft butt pad. This is the operation for the stock right here. You can tell the contour, they did think about that for low ready and then bringing it up to the shooting position. 86. We also have an adjustable cheek piece, which I am a huge fan of. 133. So it starts down here and we have one position there, one position there. That's 2. Or wait, that's 3. And there's 4. So we have 3 numbers, but 4 positions. And once again, I do like it on the number 2 position. Basically the top of this equal to the top rail. And the reason is that I am shooting this 193 height mount, which is a little bit higher than your typical AR mount. But the good thing is that even if you have a mount like this, an optic like this that's really low, you can move the cheek piece down really low and still be able to see through it. This is a Spark Solar. And if you have something like the UH-1, which is a lower scope height as well, this is the about 1.5 inches that you find typically on an AR. You can also move the cheek piece to see through that one as well. Now, it is a folding stock. Super easy to operate the folding stock. You just press this button right here and bring it around. And that, of course, does mean that you can put it in like a case or something like that, or carry it folded when you're in your vehicle and don't have the stock in your face. Will it shoot folded? We'll see how that goes. So first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna do it with the dust cover up and see if it'll shoot folded. And we're gonna put two rounds on target. Yep. All right, so we've induced a jam. The dust cover did not come down, did not eject that round out of there, as you can see. So now, will it shoot folded with the dust cover open? Yep, looks good in there. Let's try it again. Yep, okay. So it shoots and cycles just fine with the dust cover open. You can get one round off of that dust cover closed, and then you got a bad mouth, so you're almost better just smacking the stock open and shooting it from there. Good to know. Guess we should probably duplicate that. One is anomaly, two is a trend, or something. I don't know. Two is one and one is none. How about that? Ah, that time it worked. Second round though, did get a mouthy. See that right there? So, did pull two rounds that time. Missed the first one, but it did get a mouth. Interesting little mouth in there. So, confirmed it. Would not shoot the gun in that way if my life depended on it. Just smash the shit out of that thing. You'll notice that the serial number is on the upper receiver, similar to like a SCAR type of gun. The lower receiver is not serialized. It is polymer, pops out with this one pin right here. 45 degree safety, which is really cool, really comfortable. B5 systems grip. So interesting that it has a B5 systems grip, because in my last video that I was talking about an IWI product, we were looking at the Galil Ace. And I mentioned that, this is the Gen 2. So it has a grip that sort of fits that corporate identity for IWI. Now in the instruction booklet, this guy right here, it looks like it has like a pre-production grip, but it is this style and it does look like it is detachable. So somewhere out there, there's a design for a grip. This one from B5 Systems, it's their more vertical grip. It works really well and it allows this me and my mechanics to use the stock on a shorter, shorter setting, which is great because all of the weight of the gun is out front here. So that really helps with balance of the gun. And it's not back in like that, that A2 style, just has a better grip angle. Now you probably noticed in this view that it does have a left-handed magazine release, which is really cool. So, left-handed mag release, and then the bolt catch, you can press this and hold the bolt open. There's the bolt release. That was a 427. So my hands just naturally went to the paddle on the left side as I was reloading. So let's try that again. And we'll do that paddle again, get a couple of them down, and then we'll switch to the controls on the right side. All right, 397, but I did miss that first shot. Give me half credit on that. And it does have that on the right-hand side as well. So here is the bolt hold open. Just depress that, rack the charging handle, and then releases right there. And then of course, here's your magazine release on the left or the right side, and then your safety on the left or the right side for your left hand. Really cool. That was a whole mess and a half with a 516. I had all kinds of problems there. First shot was a miss, and that kind of threw me for the rest. Yeah. And then the mag stuck. I don't think it was the gun. I think it was the way I was pressing it, but we'll try it again here and see. All right, 490. All right, I'm gonna have to get used to the mag drop on this because it's much higher than my finger wants to go. The receivers on these are really tall. I'll have to put it next to an AR and see like if they're much taller. But this is higher than my finger wants to go. And I think it's because I'm used to my ADM receiver. That's my three gun rifle, where the drop is right here. So it's just a completely different design that we're getting used to, and that's okay. That's what we're out here for. There we go, 411, that wasn't too bad. So now you're gonna notice that the charging handle is over here on the right side. So it's super easy to adjust the charging handle, swap it from left-handed to right-handed. And that is just hold the bolt open, slide it to this open position, and then push it on through. Super simple. Whoa. Super simple. And now it's on the left side for a right handy. Love it. So I have shot this a couple times before, and I have found myself when loading, going back here to try to reach the charging handle, and it's never there. So I just have to keep in mind that on the buzzer, we're gonna do beep, magazine in, rack charging handle, and then go for it from there. So see how that goes. And I am loading from my belt. I've got my typical three gun belt with an LAG tactical pouch. See how that one goes. .452. All right, that one felt completely different. The charging handle was not where I was expecting it to be, because when it locked back, it was back here a little bit. So let's try that again. Ah. Whew, that just felt weird. Whacked my thumb on the scope mount. So what it is the charging handle, here, I'll just show you. We'll lock this bad boy back. So the charging handle is in the same place. You can see the bolts locked back. Charging handle's in the same place, but there's no resistance. So when you whack, when you touch it, it just goes all the way back. It's not necessarily a bad thing. It's just, that's not what I was expecting. And I went like this and whacked my thumb on the scope mount. So when you do that, pull it back and let it go, goes forward. So I think we'll stick to the other two methods instead of pulling the charging handle, but good to know. Ejection port is only on the right side. Brass deflector does work pretty well to keep that out of your face. So I don't think you can ever make lefties completely happy, but at least it has all of the other controls. Magazine well does have a really good flare on it for the magazine. .360. And then of course we have an aluminum handguard, which does have M-lock, as you would expect for things made in the USA. It did come with this Sling QD right here, which I've attached toward the back. Also came with two of these sling mounts. I've already lost one, but this does go up front here. And then there is a QD in the back. And then there's also this sling mount in the back. Now I did already try this out with my Magpul MS2 or something sling. QD goes up front, and then I had this guy here thinking that it would go on the back, and it does, but it kind of sticks out and doesn't move, and so it's not real comfortable. So I took the QD, ran it up here, hooked the Magpul sling on there, and it works just fine. Now there is, again, QDs on both sides, and then this loop on both sides. And I think this is for like a cable or paracord sort of attachment. So if that's your bag, that'll totally work for you there. Now the top rail here runs the entire length from the back where the stock comes in to just right here, which is amazing. So there's all this room, and that is fantastic as well. Again, because the bulk of the weight of the gun is out here because of the piston system. That means I can put the scope farther forward and the stock farther in, which I really liked in this case. Brought the firing hand back closer to me, which I thought was cool. So you're not way far out there. Now this piece here is integral to the handguard. So whatever you have mounted on here will stay zeroed with the handguard. And then this piece, once you take the handguard off, this piece just remains. We do have a two-position adjustable gas system, one for suppressed and one for unsuppressed. One of the things I did in a previous video with the SIG was I changed it to the suppressed setting just to see if it would run with full power ammo. It did not. So we're gonna do that right now and see if this one will. We're shooting full power ammo today. It is some Wolf Gold currently. So we're now on the suppressed setting, full power ammo. Nope. You tell me what that did when I did that. Let's rack it again. Oh, it ejected the round. It just did not drag the new one in there. So watch that closely. Tell me what it does. I can see out of the corner of my eye, I did throw the round over there. But no, it did not see another one in. It'll shoot on the lowest setting, but it will not cycle the gun. And I don't know if that's very valuable. So good to know. So again, we have a 5.56 NATO chrome lined cold hammer forge barrel, which is pretty dang awesome. The width on the barrel, according to my fancy plastic calipers, is about 0.6 inches, which makes it kind of a pencil profile and maybe even a little bit smaller than a pencil profile. Moving forward is this unique muzzle brake to the Carmel. Honestly, I was not expecting much from this muzzle brake. It looks super simple. Sometimes the simple designs are the best ones. It actually works really good. So according to the specs, the gun does weigh 8.2 pounds without the magazine and without the scope. Most of that weight is out front because of like the piston system, but they did shave down the barrel to mitigate the weight and the heft that the original design has. And it actually handles really well. And again, it's because you can bring that heft back in toward you with the shorter stock length because of the generous rail that they have here for the optic. So lots of features, looks really good on paper. And the question is like, how does it shoot? Well, it actually shoots pretty good.
Hit. Hit. Hit.
Recoil management on this gun is super easy. I gotta give IWI props because they spent money where it matters. So I worked in aerospace for a number of years, and I worked with a bunch of brilliant engineers. And one of the things that they always talked about was engineering for the intended purpose and knowing that like a human is going to be using what you're designing. IWI put money where it matters. Like, this is a really good handguard. It feels good in your hands. This is really good control. It feels good in your hands. The safety feels good in your hands. The trigger has a pretty good trigger pull and feels good in your hands, which, by the way, we should bust out the trigger gauge here. 5 pounds, 10 ounces, 5 pounds, 9 ounces. The trigger is a two-stage with a lot of take-up on the front. So that first stage is 2 pounds, 1 ounce, and a pretty easy break on the second stage. So pretty consistent 5 pound, 9 ounce break. I would not have guessed that. The fact that it's a two stage makes it feel much, much better. The trigger feel is good on this one. It doesn't have like a super hard wall. It has like a pretty good rolling brake. That's how I describe it, but it's actually a pretty good trigger. But the gun is not without its drawbacks. If you know me, I always have a few gripes about guns, and same thing here. However, they are pretty minor. My first one does center on the trigger. This is a proprietary trigger design for this gun, and it just doesn't have any aftermarket options right now. But I mean, it's a brand new gun, so hopefully something will come down in the future. The second one is that this handguard is freaking huge. I know a lot of people obsess over handguards and what's the perfect one to fit your hand and everything like that. This one is an American Defense Manufacturing. It's their competition lightweight rail. So this was what I'm used to shooting, and it shoots really well. However, I like to think that as a human, I can adapt to different things in different situations, and this is one of those situations. After a while of shooting this, it did definitely get used to it. And lastly, like I mentioned, you know, Stanag mags, your typical AR-15 mags right here, which of course means that you can use other magazines that I can't show you on YouTube, like the D60 or the 40 rounder or whatever else. However, one thing that you cannot use with this gun is the coupled magazines. So for my YouTube friends who will inevitably review this video, these are just 30 round magazines, which are legal on YouTube. And this is a coupler that we use in competition to create a stable base when we're shooting prone. So as you can see right here, this magazine comes into contact in some cases with the paddle and sometimes will not lock it back. Well, it did in this case, but when I was firing it, sometimes it would just tap that and send the bolt home and not lock it back on the last round. Also, on this side, you can't insert the magazine without hitting the dust cover. And if you put the dust cover up and put the magazine in there, now when you fire it, it induces a malfunction. That's kind of a bummer. The cheap Magpul couplers that Magpul sells do not work on this gun. That's a small price to pay, especially when there are other options available for more capacity. Just in competition, we like to use these as a stable platform to shoot from, like as a hasty bipod kind of thing, and you can't do it in this one. Future plans from IWI for the Carmel include a SBR, possibly a 14.5-inch pin and welded version, and then maybe some colors. IWI has put out a green and a tan Masada, and I think this bad boy in green or tan would look really cool. Future plans for me, so this is a long-term tester. Again, we only have like 200 rounds on it right now, so I am going to do some longer range shooting. I'll report back on that. Tomorrow, I'm shooting a three-gun match. I'll report back on that. And then I did get a comment on one of my YouTube shorts with featuring this gun, when someone asked, is this an unbullpupped X95? And I thought that was kind of interesting, and I don't even know. So I'm going to disassemble this thing to clean it, which is okay on YouTube. And I'm also going to take my X95 and disassemble that and clean it next to each other so we can see if it truly is an unbullpupped X95. And you can actually watch that video right here if you're interested in it. Thanks for watching this one.